Good morning and welcome to the 34th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item 3 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're all agreed, thank you very much. Our next item is an evidence session on the winter heating payment. The Scottish Government laid the Winter Heating Assistance Low Income Scotland Regulations 2023 on the 16th of November. The committee will consider the instrument next week and decided to hold an evidence session ahead of that session with the Minister for Social Security and Local Government. I welcome to the meeting Fraser Scott, Chief Executive Officer at Energy Action Scotland, and Dr Mark Simpson, Acting Co-Chair of the Scottish Commission on Social Security, who are both joining us remotely. Good morning and thanks very much for coming up for attending this morning. We've got a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So for witnesses and members attending remotely, please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Please also allow our broadcasting colleagues just a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. You can also indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans or simply with a show of your hand if you wish to come in on a question. Please don't feel like you have to answer every single question. If you've nothing new to add to what's been said by the other witness, that's okay. And colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question. Members online should use the chat box or WhatsApp. So I will begin the question. I will kick off straight away with Deputy Convener Emma Wood.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, witnesses. My first question is directed towards Fraser. I noticed the map that's been provided to us in the written evidence, and that 6 of the 7 areas with the highest levels of fuel poverty are in the Highlands and Islands, but I am aware that many of these areas haven't triggered a cold weather payment in quite some years. So is the winter heating payment going to be a move in the right direction in tackling fuel poverty by getting money to those who are hardest hit? Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, members. I think one of the things I will say is that the flat £50 payment affords very little heat. At typical usage for a household, that's about 7.3 days of heat. And next winter, if it's not operated in line with something, it will fall to 6 days of heat next winter. And I say operated. We know that energy costs come the 1st of April and therefore through next winter will be 25% higher than they are this winter. They're not changing at a rate consistent with inflation. They have their own rate of inflation, which is considerably higher and has been considerably higher. I think one of the things for me that the map demonstrates is the geographic inequalities that exist in fuel poverty, and a universal flat payment of £50 does not recognise those geographic inequalities or indeed socio-economic inequalities that are also evident, or indeed the health inequalities that will exist in society. The detriment experienced in communities with lower average temperatures off gas typically is going to be great. In 2020-21, Aviemore, Braemar, and people who were eligible in those communities all received multiple payments worth over 50 days of warmth. And they will now receive, in this winter, just 7. There's considerable detriment to be recognised as a consequence of moving to a flat payment. I appreciate that over time, the pattern is weather-related. And I know that this is a feature of the change, is that breaking the link between the weather and people's circumstances. But quite clearly, in parts of Scotland, the weather can be extreme, and the pattern is quite evident over a number of years that when it is extreme, my worry and my concern is what will step in to support those households who now will experience the greatest levels of detriment because they're off gas, they're perhaps probably in the Highlands, Braemar, Aviemore and other communities. They will see significant detriment which will be enhanced or increased by other inequalities such as underlying health conditions or disability or families with young children or older people. And it isn't clear to me what the plan is, should there be an extreme weather event for a sustained period of time. But will it help fuel poverty, insofar as it provides a financial boost to all households? It will do something, but it will be a very, very small effect because in essence, it's £1 a week over a year. So the impact that it will have on fuel poverty is negligible. What I would have argued is that if it had been better designed, it could have had a significant life-saving, life-impacting effect in the parts of Scotland where we know it to be the case that they have the highest levels of fuel poverty, and with better consequential targeting, some of those households who live there who have underlying health conditions or disability or older people or children or families with young children, they could have been better targeted.
Thank you. That's really clear. And I think, you know, we do need to recognise that minus one will feel like minus one in a lot of places, but in Ireland and a lot of rural communities, minus one will feel like minus five and there's no protection from wind. Do you think at all that the winter heating payment will be easier to build upon than the cold weather payments? And what would you like to see happen to make it more effective at tackling fuel poverty?
I guess obviously there's a few things I would like to see. The qualifying date for me is a weakness against the cold weather payment, which was a rolling eligibility. So that's a weakness, as is the gap between qualifying date and payment received, which is 3 months in this instance. So it may change, but let's say it's the 3 months that, as is provided for within the regulations. The cold weather payment pays out within 14 days of an event, much closer to the experience of households. My concern is that households are struggling right now. We've seen an acceleration in the rate at which people have been moved from credit to prepayment. The cash flow requirements for households in those circumstances is great. People will be making immediate current decisions on heat, eat or survive. And to have to wait to receive an amount of money, considerable period, and in the period potentially after the coldest weather has occurred, people may have gone without as a result for fear of being in debt to energy suppliers. And I would say that the Scottish Government can do this. It has done this in other areas. There's no rural uplift, for example, for these off-gas homes through this benefit. Yet Scottish Government grants for things like energy efficiency or heat pumps, as announced just last week, do have a rural uplift for the provision of those things. So it is possible, and there's no attempt to understand the circumstances experienced by individuals. And there's a breadth of circumstances. The efficiency of your home is important to understand as well. Yet the Scottish Government's own Fuel Insecurity Fund, which does provide payments to householders, does recognise that and provides varying amounts to struggling households, whether that's to clear debt or to pre-purchase heating oil or LPG or other fuels. So it doesn't seek to provide a flat universal provision. It looks to provide a differentiated payment based on circumstance. But I think it's possible to do it. I hope that this is something to build on, but I fear that it quickly becomes swallowed up, as it is at this point in time, a small payment against rising energy costs and the relief or the respite that it provides to households who are eligible is brief, and all too brief, and may not be sufficient enough to save lives. And for those who miss out the most, based on previous experiences, their lives genuinely are at risk. These older households in those areas traditionally that received more multiple payments across previous years.
Thank you very much, Emma. I'll now move to questions from James Dornan, who is joining us online.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to start off just going back to Fraser. My questions were actually going to be for Mark, but given what you've just said there, it's not just these areas that are affected by cold weather. There's areas within cities that are affected pretty badly within cold weather. There's people who'd be affected that if we were working the way that you're suggesting, they might have missed out on it. So surely whichever method that's used, the likelihood is you're not going to get everybody in. And this way, at least everybody's getting something.
Yep, thank you for that as well. I mean, I think in previous evidence we had suggested that the cold weather payment system was a far from perfect system, simply because it was based on a certain number of weather stations across Scotland, which created the catchments for qualification, and that wasn't to say that they were correct. I think all I'm reflecting on is the difference between what's proposed and what previously existed. There were good elements to the cold weather payment. The rolling eligibility, the 14-day response for payment is good and is significantly better than is afforded by the provisions of the regulations that we're about to introduce. There was opportunity to look at maintaining the weather connection, and there are other climatic factors that could have been brought into the provision. For example, we could have looked at not just the absolute temperature, but as I think as previous question suggested, that it can feel different. That's also that wind chill factor is measured by our weather stations, and the pattern of weather stations could have been increased. So I'm simply saying there were other options available, and we could have retained some of those best features. And I think over time we could have also looked at the enhancement based on the kind of the efficiency of a person's home, because two similar houses in two similar locations in Scotland will have different experiences in terms of their heat demand. But the flat universal payments do not recognise that. And that's been the pattern of government's support. UK government support and Scottish government support in a large, to a large extent, has been flat and universal. I did point out that the Fuel Insecurity Fund has gone further than that with a similar £20 million type budget. But I think it's possible to do it. I think we just need a level of sophistication. Perhaps we don't have that sophistication, but we are breaking the link between extreme weather and this payment. And in extreme weather circumstances, what will government's response be?
Well, we do have the Minister in front of us, and we'll be asking a lot of these questions when the Minister's here, but thanks very much for that. Can I ask Mark, the breaking the link with the weather, how does that align with the statutory social security principles? Do you think it impacts on them, or do you think it's in line with them?
Okay, thanks for the question. I mean, the first thing I'll say on this, which I'm sure I've said before in front of the committee, is that, you know, any question about alignment with the social security principles is never straightforward, because they, you know, they can pull in different directions and their interpretations aren't always set in stone. So I'll focus on a couple of principles. Principle that social security should contribute to poverty reduction, principle that the government should seek to continuously improve the system, and the principle that the system should be efficient, because I think when we were writing our report at the Commission, those seemed to be the most relevant. So breaking the link with the temperature will increase the contribution of social security to poverty reduction in most parts of Scotland. I'm conscious of what Fraser has just said, that will only be to a relatively limited extent, but nonetheless, it does represent an improvement from the perspective of most of the people who receive a low income benefit in those areas. But as we've already heard, the opposite may and likely will apply in some areas where there have been three or more cold weather payments in recent years. So in Braemar in particular, that's been a really regular occurrence. It's probably easier to see that making this uniform payment of £50 is a gain in terms of administrative efficiency. And indeed, you know, we talked about the retention of a cold weather contingent element to the payment in the report. The Scottish Government's response to that recommendation seems to indicate that they think we underestimated the administrative challenges that are associated with retaining a temperature contingent payment, and in terms of the relationship between the Met Office and Social Security Scotland that would be required. So that's certainly a point on which the committee might want to seek some further clarification next week when you have the opportunity.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Your answer actually just highlights the complexity of whichever way we go, there's going to be winners and losers, which is an unfortunate phrase to use, but that not everybody's going to be treated equally. Can I just What's your views on not making additional payments to those areas that you've talked about, those ones that are that experience more than 3 weeks below freezing temperatures? How much of a difference do you think that's going to make? How much of an impact is it going to have?
Well, I mean, I'm slightly reluctant to speculate too much on that. I mean, Fraser's submission that you all have in front of you, it sets out really vividly what the consequences could be if there's widespread inability to meet energy costs. But, you know, we can't say that that's going to be the inevitable consequence that's directly relatable to, you know, someone in Aviemore getting £50 of support when they might previously have got 75. You know, what we can say is, you know, these payments, they don't target people who merely have a low income. They're people who are on an out-of-work benefit. They're also likely to have higher heating costs because of the nature of their household composition. So it's certainly the case that every pound they can get counts, and that's, you know, that's truer than ever this winter. So we did suggest in our report that one consequence of this could be that that the colder areas, maybe more areas other than the colder areas, see additional applications to the Scottish Welfare Fund if people are struggling to see their or to meet their energy costs. And we did suggest that the government might consider putting a bit more money into the welfare fund allocation for certain local authorities. Now their response tells us that would be incompatible with the current approach to distributing that money. I'm not going to argue against that, but you know, it certainly seems clear that local authorities across Scotland can probably anticipate cold weather triggering crises for some households this winter, and certainly being an area that has historically experienced more of these cold spells is one factor that might increase the likelihood of this. It is interesting that the Scottish Government response to the report says that they retain the ability to legislate for additional payments should this arise and should the funding be available, but it's not really clear what that would mean in practice or what the current thinking is on when an additional payment would actually be triggered and who it would be made to.
Yeah, I think that will be an area of questioning for the Minister when he's in front of us as well. Okay, thank you very much. But just before I go, is it not clear that from both the answers that a lot of the issues that we're facing here are not just down to this payment, it's down to all the other factors that people under these circumstances are having to face?
Okay, it's a much bigger issue. You know, there's the payment only becomes an issue because there are existing vulnerabilities, and those are due to people's income from other sources, including other social security benefits, and they're due to weather, and they're due to your heating system and your insulation. It's not a straightforward issue.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, James. We'll now move to questions from Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Kumira, and good morning, panel. I wonder if I can go back to Fraser just for a moment, just one question, which really follows up my two colleagues' questions. Clearly next week, all we can do is vote yes or no for these regulations, and I would suspect we would all vote yes next week. But looking ahead, Fraser, if you could have another year, so you've got 6 or 9 months to redesign these regulations, what would you be saying to us as a committee and to the Scottish Government to improve these regulations? Can we do it through this, or is it better, the Government indicates, to create a new benefit, which we have the power to do here in Scotland? So is it amending these regulations or a new benefit, if that's possible to answer that one?
I think one thing to say is that the benefit system is the best way to reach people on the lowest incomes and some of the greatest vulnerabilities, without a doubt. So anything that we can do to improve our benefit system, I would vote for, absolutely. And if I was given 12 more months, what would I look to see at the end of 12 more months was a benefit that is far better targeted at the things that we know are true for people who are already on benefits in relation to fuel poverty, for example. So we have a Fuel Poverty Act in Scotland. it talks about the enhanced heating requirement. So the Act recognises that some households have an enhanced heating requirement. So therefore, greater levels of consumption are expected to be achieved for those households. Our benefit system should, in a greater way, actually acknowledge and act in a way to respond to that. So it does, for child winter heating assistance, I would say that's an excellent benefit because it does indeed provide for households with children with a disability who the Act would recognise as having an enhanced heating requirement. However, it doesn't go beyond that point. It doesn't go into adults with disability or older households or people who may have life-impacting or life-limiting conditions. But the Act exists, and a better alignment with the Act and Social Security is what I would aim for. I think we should learn from this winter, without a doubt, we'll have to. I would be surprised that a payment that comes in February of a winter period is going to be particularly effective for households, because it will not have provided them with the heat or power for their homes in the periods when they needed it, particularly for those low-income households who have a greater prevalence of the use of prepayment meters, whose cash flow requirements are significantly different to households who have direct debit or credit. So something that recognises these circumstances. And beyond that, in the future, I would hope that we could scale provision. If this provision is about heat and warmth, and there is inequality in people's experiences that can be changed, so as the energy efficiency of homes changes, that someone who lives in a B energy efficient rated home over someone who lives in a G rated energy efficient home and is eligible for qualification, funding should be scaled to provide equity, not universality.
Thank you for that. And one quick question to Dr Simpson. The Scottish Government argues that most people will gain under these proposals, but they recognise that some people won't gain. Have you done any analysis of who gains, but maybe perhaps more importantly, who loses out in regard to this? Is it simply a geographical question, or is it an issue around disability as well?
Well, it's an issue around disability in as much as the you know, the eligibility criteria are based on low income plus another factor, of which disability is one, alongside having an older person or a very young child in the house. But whether you're a winner or loser within those categories is more geographically determined. So if you're in an area that would you under the previous regime have met the temperature condition for a cold weather payment being made on three or more occasions during the winter. So that's usually Braemar, and it's sometimes Aviemore, Loughgloss, Carnock and Tullock Bridge. They're the main areas that we're talking about. That's where the losers are going to be concentrated. If you're elsewhere, and particularly if you're outside the islands, then you know you might be receiving a payment for the first time in many years, or maybe the first time ever. So that's relatively easy to identify. I suppose something to highlight around that is that, you know, although the number of people who stand to lose out is fairly small, the Commission's report highlights that in the original 2019 position paper on the devolution of this area of support, the government stated that nobody would lose out at that point. So there's clearly been a change of position on that. And again, that's something that members might want to explore next week. If I might add just a little bit to Fraser's answer to your previous question as well, there's a recurring theme in this devolutionary journey that we're all on, that there's only a limited amount of tinkering that can be done at the same time as an area of social security is transferred from the DWP to the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland. And it's become quite common in Scots reports to kind of look ahead to, you know, after that process has been finished and say, you know, here's a few things you might think about in a future review. And with an eye to that, in the report on this particular payment, you know, we did highlight specifically the cold weather contingent element. the possible inclusion of in-work claimants of universal credit and the necessity of a qualifying week, or where the qualifying week should be as part of a future review. But there's also, and I think this aligns with what Fraser said, there's going to be a need to look at that wider winter heating assistance landscape, because there's various different payments to various different people, and it might be possible to rationalise that a little bit in the future. But all that needs to be kind of considered alongside the sort of the non-social security responses, things that can reduce people's consumption and reduce their costs, as well as just helping them pay the bills. So I think it's an area where there could be a lot of thinking to be done as we move along the road.
Thank you, Camino.
Thanks very much, Jeremy. We'll now move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy to finish us off for theme one.
Thank you very much, Convener. And good morning, Mark and Fraser. Thank you for the submissions that you gave us in advance, but also for the questions you've answered so far. Some of the questions I had have already been answered, so I won't repeat them in the interest of time. I'll start with a question for yourself, Mark, if that's okay. In your submission, you say that breaking the winter link is retrogressive in terms of human rights. Can you explain this a bit more? And that the Scottish Government's answer, I think, as far as I can tell, seems to be that the unreliability of cold weather is difficult for low-income families, and a predictable one-off payment is better. How would you respond to that, given the comments about human rights?
The issue of non-retrogression, it aligns quite closely with the continuous improvement principle. So we're required to conduct our scrutiny with a view to the UK's human rights commitments, and particularly to the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. And the non-retrogression principle is really at the heart of the covenant, because it doesn't always give a great deal of clarity on what level of service is required to fulfil a right. But one thing that it is quite clear on is that I guess progress should be forwards. That the level of provision should not be rolled back unless there's a very good reason for doing so. And I mean, I should be clear that, you know, our report states that we consider that the introduction of the new payment will be a step forward, will represent an improvement for most of the people who are affected. But that doesn't mean that it's unimportant that there is this group in the areas that have, you know, more often experienced cold weather, for whom the level of support will be reduced. You know, in Braemar, in one recent year, there was a total of £175 in cold weather payments were made. So to drop from that down to 50 is quite significant, potentially for the households affected. But equally, as I've mentioned previously, there are other areas in which people may never have received a cold weather payment at all. So they're receiving £50 where they might have received nothing. So it's not a uniform picture, but I think the fact that only a minority of people experience that retrogression doesn't mean that it can be ignored. Sorry, was there another part of your question that I've missed there?
No, I don't think so. I'd asked about the unreliability of a cold weather and the more reliabilities. Yes. You kind of touched on it, but if you have more to add.
Yeah, I mean, weather is unpredictable to an extent, but it's fairly predictable that winters in Braemar are going to be cold.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Fraser, you said a moment ago that you would vote for anything that improves the benefit system. And I share that view. Do you think this improves the benefit system?
I think it does provide a universal uplift to people. I don't think the benefit system generally provides sufficient levels of basic income to households. So on that front, yes, the value of it, though, at £1 a week, is not a significant amount, or it's not significant enough of an amount. I mean, touching on what Mark just said when he talked about the payment that was received in Braemar of £175 versus the £50. Now, that simply looks like a £125 detriment. But what you have to bear in mind is that when that £175 was received, the energy costs of that household were 2.5 times less than they are now. Mm. So actually, the scale of the detriment is significantly greater than is evident in the financial dimension alone. And the impact that it will have on those households in terms of what they cannot achieve is incredibly significant. But for me, what happens? What happens next? So in those households who once received, who do not receive, the National Health Service will be left to pick up the pieces. Those households are more likely to seek visits to their GP's practice or to be admitted to hospital as a consequence, particularly where they have an underlying health condition which simply has been made worse by the lack of heat and power that they've been able to achieve. And I know that the numbers of people we're talking about are relatively small, but whose life in this space is worth less? Because actually we are going to consign some households in some areas to considerably poorer provision of support than was previously afforded. And even if that's one person whose life is lost, we could foresee that this could happen, and we have not put in place a protection that will ensure that there is indeed no detriment to that household, then we are failing. And therefore, is that an improvement on the system? I don't think that's the improvement, but that's definitely a failing of the moment that we have in front of us.
Thank you. And just one very brief follow-up on that. Appreciate that, Fraser. Do you know how many people will lose out? Do you have a figure for that?
That I don't have in front of me. No, I don't. I think it's been harder for us to gain the access to that level of detail within the benefit system over the number of households in places. We get the trigger information, absolutely. It's just been much harder to gain that information. I hope that's a question you can ask Social Security Scotland, because surely they must know.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pam. And I would just say that I've actually sought some clarification in terms of how many households received the cold weather payment over the last few years, so that we have an understanding of who will lose out or who will gain. Sorry, I think James Dornan wants to come in with a quick supplementary on that.
Sorry, go back to Fraser, but Fraser, you seem to be almost suggesting that all the ills of the people that in Braemar are down to this payment. That if these people in Braemar are losing out, and that is tragic, if it goes round the other way, the way it used to be, then you've got people in Glasgow and other areas that are losing out just now. So it's not a case of everybody's going to be sorted if it was the other way, or the old way, or this way. Surely it's going to be almost impossible to get a system where everybody is covered.
It's always going to be difficult to design a system where you've got no gaps, without a doubt. But what is clear to me is that we know, Scottish Government knows, for example, from the work that's done in the Scottish House Condition Survey, and is recognised in the Fuel Poverty Strategy, that there are inherent inequalities across Scotland. The levels of consumption of energy that are required to achieve the same levels of comfort enjoyed in different parts of Scotland, they are not the same. In some parts of the Highlands and Islands, households are consuming double the levels of GB average consumption to keep their homes warm, as a consequence of things like being off gas. So in Glasgow, for example, households are typically on gas, and in the Highlands they are not. And the cost of keeping the exact same house warm in the Highlands that you would find in Glasgow will be greater. So the cost differential to achieve the same levels of comfort, and therefore the same levels of protection for life, are different. And therefore, you know, for me, that's a flaw in a universal provision, is that it doesn't recognise that and has no protection afforded where those circumstances exist, and we know that they exist.
I could debate with you about the level of housing in some of the areas in Glasgow, but I better leave that for another day.
Thank you, James. Yes, we've spent quite a lot of time on that first section of questions, so I'll maybe need to hurry people along a little bit more as we move on. We will move now to theme two, level of payment, and I will bring in my colleague Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Convener, and I note your comments on time, so I'll try and keep it as quick as I can. It's really just the first question to yourself, probably Fraser, and I'm bringing Mark in. Obviously, we've discussed around about the £50 at the moment, and I think you've both touched on other payments that are kind of out there, and the broader context, I suppose, of trying to support people, the most vulnerable in our society. Now, we're in a context of recession, tight budgets, and, of course, within a fixed budget in Scotland, if we take the money from this budget to be more, then, of course, we need to be taking it from another budget, another line. I'm just wondering, in terms of the context about other payments that are out there, and Fraser, I don't know if there's any comments about, you talked about obviously about targeting, how we could look at it in the round, how that could be better targeted in that regard, because you mentioned about that, but within the context of other payments, I don't know if you want to comment on that one.
Thanks, Paul. I mean, I think you're right, there's been an awful lot of one-off payments provided. As government, UK government, let's start with there, UK government has provided them and has defined them as one-off payments. And what we've seen this year is a whole range of payments, many of which have gone through Social Security, which does mean they are automatic. And that's good that they're automatic. But the value of those payments against the scale of the change that households are facing is still, it's a lot of money. But the impact for households is they're still going to see a doubling of their energy costs, even with the support that they're able to attract, whether that's the uplifts on universal credit or the amount for older households or for people with disability that are being provided automatically, or indeed the £400 universal payment, which obviously is problematic in itself for many households who've yet to receive the benefit of it, particularly again, those prepayment meter households who haven't, many of whom have not redeemed vouchers on that £400. But there's also a much broader level of crisis support. And I guess I now fear the word crisis because it seems like it's normal. We're normalising the crisis. There is a lot of crisis funding available to households, uplifts to help with prepayment, to deal with some debt. But the bottom line is the system is broadly broken. It's not been fair, it doesn't have people at the heart of it, but it isn't working well for me. And as I look ahead to the winter in front of us for 2023, the provision of support for households falls relative to this year. There has been more support provided this year than will be provided next year, and energy costs will be 25% higher next year than this year. So looking ahead, it's going to be even harder. So this payment in the context of that, for me, I struggle with it. It's £50 set against, it's like a finger in a dam. You know, and I think what we need to see is a far more integrated set of supports provided to households than we have. And for households who receive it, those who've never received one before, this will be a boost, as we've talked about already. That idea that there's still detriment that we recognise in introducing it, and we have not offset or mitigated that detriment, again, feels like a failure of design. And we need to get these things right, because the consequence of getting them wrong can be catastrophic for households. And for me, that's always the bottom line in all of this. It can be catastrophic for households, and we know it to be the case. We've got the highest levels of winter mortality. We're one of the highest levels of winter mortality anywhere in Europe. We have some of the poorest quality housing. And I know that in the previous question I got there, there are more issues at play here. Yeah, there's access to gas, there's the issues about equity in the price of energy and other things. But you know, the bottom line is the consequence of getting things wrong right now can be catastrophic.
Fraser.
Yeah. I think Mark would like to come in on that point. point.
I've just had a supplementary, just to get Mark to comment on that as well. Fraser, absolutely. just on that, one of the key things, obviously, there's a review of the Scottish Welfare Fund going on just now, and obviously that can be targeted on a local authority basis, which maybe can you pick up the points that you're talking around about how we get, I suppose, the fairest scheme that's out there. I don't know what your comments, your thoughts would be on, you know, almost trying to look at through the Welfare Fund, where there is that discretionary element for local authorities then to target where they know there are particular issues, for example, rural areas where it might be oil-based. So I don't know what your thoughts on that. Can you just touch on that? And then I know Mark wants to come on that, but just on that specific point.
I think it's been important that we have had other supports available. But the weakness in many of those other supports is that they require applications to be made by very vulnerable people, people who are struggling, people whose mental health has taken a significant hit simply because of the cost of living crisis and the impact that's having on their household. And for me, the more that can be done to provide automatic support, the better. And it may still require us to provide other supports for households who fall out with the scope of those automatic provisions. But what we have at the moment is many people who are eligible for payments through Social Security are having to still go to crisis funding to get support in order just to get through this winter.
Yeah. Thanks, Fraser. Mark, what to come in?
Yeah, absolutely. In the Commission's report, we did point to the Welfare Fund as, you know, a possible means of addressing some of the gaps that this might exist, but I mean, that doesn't mean it's the ideal means, because, you know, as Fraser's already alluded to, you know, it's not just a case under the Welfare Fund of a local authority targeting money where it knows there's an issue. It depends on people submitting an application, but an application that is in effect an admission that I am in crisis, and psychologically that's not always easy for people to do. I think that wider question of adequacy is a tricky one. I don't particularly get a sense that the level of this payment has been devised with an eye to what would be enough, in inverted commas. You know, it's been informed by the level of two cold weather payments and a political calculation about what can be afforded at present. But it's also a small piece of a much bigger jigsaw. You know, Fraser's paper is really uncompromising on when it sets out the way in which energy costs have outstripped the level of support provided to low-income households. But that support is a blend of UK Social Security, Scottish Social Security, and the additional payments that have been made available recently by both governments. So if we regard this total level of support as inadequate, it's not necessarily easy to point the finger at one particular payment and say, you know, say that's the cost. And we do emphasise in our report that winter heating payment is a contribution towards energy costs. It's not something that is intended to or ever could cover them in full. For many households, that's going to be a contribution they wouldn't have received under the previous regime, and that would certainly be welcome, but whether it's adequate is probably for others to judge.
Mark, thank you for that. Camilla, thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. We will now move on to our next theme, and I will take questions from Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, and just a really couple of questions. I think we're kind of building on what we've already discussed. A marriage in regard to eligibility criteria, and I'm particularly around those with disability, because there will be those who are on disability payments, but who are not on other benefits. So are you concerned they're going to miss out? And would you like to see the criteria extended to all adults who are on the new disability living allowance? Maybe Fraser wants to start with that.
Hey, thanks. Hey, thanks, Jeremy. I mean, I think I'm in a position where I would say I want this enhanced for everybody who's going to struggle. And without a doubt, that group of people will indeed struggle. I think in Scotland, we tend to do a little bit better over recent times in terms of inclusions of financial support for people with disability versus England and Wales. Indeed, for example, in the energy supplier provided warm home discount, In Scotland, households with disability are included in our payment, whereas in England and Wales they've been removed from the payment system. So in some respects, things that are happening in Scotland have been better. But without a doubt, all households are struggling right now. And many, many households who are just above qualification lines absolutely should be brought into scope if it's, well, one, if budgets afford, I guess is the question. But for me, it's not about the budget, it's about doing the right thing. If we believe that people's lives are at risk and that there is an opportunity to affect a change there, then we should take it. I think let someone else worry about the budget. That's my consequence. I don't have to worry about that budget. I do worry about the people, though.
Thank you. Mark, if I can just rephrase the question slightly for you, because I think in recommendation 9 of your report, you picked up that those who are on the new adult disability payment but aren't, they don't include in-work benefits, won't get this. Is that a concern for you? Would you like to see that looked at again by Scottish Government? And if so, why?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is one of the things that we highlighted as something that's you know, probably was never going to be feasible to look at this point, but that we would certainly like to see looked at in a future review. And on people who receive disability benefits, first of all, you know, it's certainly recognised by governments and the World Health Organization that disabled people will typically have higher energy costs. You know, they'll often spend more time at home and they'll often need a higher temperature while they are at home. So I think additional support for disabled people generally is something that could well merit consideration, but it isn't something that we recommended in our report as a feature of winter heating payment specifically. The reason for that is that winter heating payment is a low income benefit, and not everyone in receipt of a disability benefit is on a low income. If you're on one of the qualifying low income benefits and you've got a disabled person in the house, then you'll qualify for it already. So the position of someone who's on disability assistance but on a higher income is in a way a separate question. And I think child winter heating assistance is the more obvious model there than winter heating payments. When it comes to the to people on in-work benefits, there were a few things that I guess were on our minds there. So, I mean, first of all, there's a basic inequality in how the regulations treat people who are in work and receiving income support, employment and support allowance, or job seekers allowance. They qualify for winter heating payments on the same basis and the same way as people who are out of work and receiving the same benefits, whereas in-work claimants of universal credit can only qualify if they've got a disabled child in their family. Secondly, I think you know, we all know that there are low earners out there who will face essentially the same cost of living challenges as people on out of work benefits face. You know, they may have more income, but that extra that they're getting could well be taken up by you know, by some of the costs that they face because of their because they're in employment. And thirdly, the Social Security Charter requires the Scottish Government to work to improve people's perceptions of Social Security, and targeting providing support to people who are out of work that isn't available to very low earners is not necessarily something that's likely to help with that with that project. So those were a few things that we were thinking about, but I mean, I would emphasise that we're recommending a review of the qualifying benefits, which is something that the Scottish Government has indicated that it's open to. We're not prejudging what the outcome of that review should be. You know, there is another difference between the legacy benefits and universal credit, in that you know, income support and the others are paid to people who are out of work or only working in very few hours. People on universal credit could be working a far greater number of hours and have significantly higher earnings. So that doesn't mean that to extend eligibility to in-work universal credit claimants, but you know, to limit that to the lowest earners for consistency with the current approach on the other benefits would potentially have been a lot more work for Social Security Scotland to do to identify who has entitlements. So I guess it's another of those examples that I mentioned at the start of that sort of that administrative efficiency principle, maybe pull it in a slightly different direction to some of the other principles.
Just very quickly, Mark, I was interested in your very opening remark there, that this is not the time to do it, or the capacity is not there to do it at the moment. Sorry if I've misquoted you. I'm interested to know, why do you think that is the case? Is that because there's too much happening within Social Security Scotland for them to take this on as well? Or where's the capacity issue for you around this?
Yeah, well, I mean, I suppose capacity issues can always be addressed to some extent if there's the willingness to, you know, to spend to increase capacity. But I guess what I was really referring to was that it's something that we've seen repeatedly with the devolution of functions from DWP to Social Security Scotland. You know, we've seen it with the various forms of disability assistance. We're seeing it here, and you know, we may well see it again when carers assistance comes around, that there's kind of the first stage of the work is to get the function transferred, and you know, the government has always emphasized that mantra of safe and secure transition, that's the first priority, and that limits the scope for a comprehensive redesign at that point. And you know, and I can see why they've made that argument, but I think, I guess, what we as a commission and maybe yourselves as a committee need to be mindful of for the future is that doesn't then become that what is inherited becomes the default, and that just continues, that there is an open mind in future reviews when the time is right.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thanks, Jeremy. I'll actually just go straight back to you to lead us into theme four, which is on the qualifying week. Thank you.
Thank you. And can we glad you, this is my last question, and it will be brief. I'm going really back to what Fraser said early on, that February wasn't the right month for people to get the payment. I understand why you think that. Can you then suggest which month would be the appropriate month for the payment to be made?
Well, just got a couple of observations on that. I mean, if there's a qualifying date, then I cannot see why, after the qualifying date, it would take 3 months for a payment to be triggered. If the existing cold weather payment system can pay out within 14 days, then I can't understand why this would not pay out within 14 days of achieving the qualifying date, because that just seems like a relatively straightforward acceleration of the rate of payment. But the benefit to the household would mean that they would have that £50 more in advance of need, and therefore able to satisfy need, than receiving it in February, where they may have foregone heat and power because they simply couldn't decide whether they would be able to do that or not. Because, you know, that payment to come in February, people on the lowest incomes can't borrow that money in order to achieve that heat and power, except by getting into debt with their energy supplier. And if you're already on a prepayment meter, potentially repaying debt or having a cash flow requirement that is burdensome, people will have foregone their energy over that period when they do receive that £50. So if anything could be done now to accelerate that payment to households, I would urge the committee to recommend that to the Minister.
And can I just ask the same question to Mark? Do you have a view on this, or does the Commission have a view on this?
Well, the Commission certainly has no specific recommendation about payment dates in our report. We do know that various stakeholders have argued that payments should be made as early as possible. You know, I don't think we would disagree with that argument. I just don't think we're particularly well placed to say when the earliest possible date is likely to be.
Thank you, and thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be quick as well. Do either of you have a view about why a qualifying date was suggested as opposed to the previous approach?
You go first, Pam.
Yeah.
I have literally no idea. I can only see that the qualifying date there could be for budget certainty, and that you know on that date in November what the spend is likely to be by the time you get to the end of March. So there's probably an efficiency built into this. It clearly isn't the best thing for those households, particularly households whose economic circumstances change beyond that qualifying date in November. You know, and at this time of great uncertainty, cost of living crisis, recession, then many, many households' circumstances may indeed change beyond the qualifying date and receive no support in the way that those who do meet the qualifying date do get. Now, some say there will always be winners and losers in this space. I would still draw the parallel to the cold weather payment system, which is a rolling eligibility and a payment that can be received within 14 days. Mm-hmm. And the aspects of it being stronger than what the regulations afford for this payment.
Yeah. Like a number of the other payments that we've seen it reduced, this is the cold weather payments dependent on information from the Department for Work and Pensions to identify who is receiving the qualifying UK benefit and has the necessary household circumstances, and then that information needs to be transferred to Social Security Scotland so they can see who is entitled. And as far as I can tell, you know, having a qualifying week, it kind of it simplifies that interaction. It means that kind of go to DWP once to get that information, and then you only have to go back later to kind of mop up the people who had appeals or suspensions or reconsiderations ongoing at that time. If you extend the qualifying periods or you have multiple qualifying weeks, then you know you're having to go back to DWP more often throughout the winter to get that that information, which you know presumably would not be impossible, but it adds, I guess, to the administrative burden that would be on Social Security Scotland. That would be my understanding.
Thank you, Mark. I appreciate that. Thank you, Fraser. Mark, when you say that Social Security Scotland would need to go back to DWP, I understand that if they do it in 1 week, they get the data from that week and that's it. But if the mechanism is there to get that data once, surely it wouldn't be administratively burdensome to get that data several times over a longer period?
That's probably a question for Social Security Scotland rather than me. Clearly, yes, the mechanism exists in principle. It could be run more than once, but how much extra work that creates, someone else would be better placed to comment on.
Fair. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. I will just move straight back to you for theme five.
Thank you, Convener. The winter heating payment you note in your submission, Fraser, provides less impact on fuel poverty than the benefit it replaces. Can you, in addition to what you've already said around the kind of geographical impacts of it, can you expand on that so that we can have an understanding about the gaps in terms of addressing fuel poverty that this version of this payment creates?
Thanks, Pam. So, I mean, for me, this is around the change of circumstances. So when this benefit was planned to be introduced in 2019 and the budget was identified and the payment was determined as being £50, energy costs were 2.5 times less. So therefore, the amount of respite that it would have provided had it been introduced then would have been significantly greater than now. Now, fuel poverty rates in Scotland are rising. I mean, the Scottish Government estimates for the end of the impact of the April price increase was that it placed 1 in 3 households in fuel poverty, 1 in 4 in extreme fuel poverty. And then consequently, we've had the one-off payments from the UK government and the provisions of things through the Fuel Insecurity Fund. But all of that has done little because energy prices rose by another 20% in October. and largely wiped away the benefits afforded by those supports, leaving us with much higher levels of fuel poverty in Scotland now than in, say, 2019, 2020. In terms of its impact on fuel poverty as a £50 payment, it's going to be negligible, simply because it is a very small payment for what is now a very, very expensive and essential part of a household budget. So for me, that's the big difference, is seeing this within the context of fuel poverty. In the past, you could argue that it was targeted and has a better alignment to a fuel poverty purpose, because it sought to provide some equity in terms of the comfort available to households who received the benefit. That payment to the households in previous qualifying years tried to say that, well, you know, in those communities it was significantly colder, they had significantly higher heating demands, and the state provided a support to try and achieve a level of comfort that would have been enjoyed had to be somewhere else. Therefore, in terms of its impact on fuel poverty, it was directly relating to their energy needs and the comfort that would provide for them. Whereas, you know, this will not do that, and it will not do that for a few reasons, and one of the reasons is the scale of the benefit. If it were to have been kept, if you like, in line with energy costs, it would be well over 100 and something, £125 perhaps, would provide you with the same amount of energy that would have been afforded to households in 2019. Because energy is not rising with inflation. It has its own inflationary rise. And I think one of the things that's quite clear is that of inflation, energy in itself is about 2% of that inflation that we experience. But the inflationary impact of energy costs directly on the lowest income households is significantly greater as a proportion of their household income than it is for households with higher median incomes across Scotland. So the impact of it is going to be negligible in terms of fuel poverty. And for me, you know, that if we look at this in maybe a year's time, is how do we align this better so that it has more of an impact on those fuel poverty figures? And for me, that can only be through better targeting and a better recognition of things like the enhanced heating requirement within the Fuel Poverty Act and what this benefit could do to support that.
Thank you. I appreciate that, Fraser. And on the same theme, a quick question for Mark, if that's okay. You've highlighted in your response, and you noted a few moments ago, that there needs to be a review of the kind of fuel payment infrastructure in Scotland. Have you discussed that with the Scottish Government, and can you comment on whether they're likely to do this, or whether they want to do this?
Well, I mean, we've been asked, our task is to scrutinise draft regulations that come before us, so that's what we focused on for these. But you know, we can't be blind to the wider context when we do this. You know, where there's ultimately there are going to be separate payments provided that are intended to provide support with energy costs for people with low incomes, people with a disabled child in the house, and for pensioner households, and you know, with potentially various gaps remaining in that architecture, as we've been hearing about this morning. So no, we haven't had any specific discussions with the Scottish Government on what a more rationalised future system might look like. But you know, it's not impossible to conceive of a move towards a kind of a similar payment that gives, or you know, a similar benefit that gives different amounts to people depending on their circumstances. But I think that's probably one for the future.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for joining us. I had two short questions to close. Firstly, with regards to the discussion we've had this morning, what other support do you think the Scottish Government should be providing to families and individuals struggling with the cost of energy? Do you want to come in, Mark, as your
Yeah, well, I mean, the income that people use on their, you know, the income that people receive is compartmentalised into different payments, but it's not, you know, it doesn't stay compartmentalised when it comes into their accounts. So when they're meeting their energy costs, they're drawing on all the resources at their disposal. So, you know, from that point of view, if you're an out-of-work parent to a three-year-old, what's going to make a difference to your ability to pay your energy bills this winter is not so much the introduction of winter heating payment, it's the recent increases to the level of Scottish Child Payments. You know, so there's a wider package of support there that people will be drawing on. But, you know, I think I've said already this morning that Social Security, the only part and can only be part of the solution to fuel poverty, it needs to sit alongside that focus on consumption and cost as well. You know, that's for parts of government other than the Social Security Directorate, and it's probably more Fraser's area of expertise than it is mine.
Thank you. Fraser, did you want to come in on that?
I think the answer is always much, much more. I mean, there has to be more support than has been provided. We have to do the best that we can for all the people who are absolutely struggling every single day and struggling right now. Scotland has record levels of energy debt. It has record amounts of people who are being moved from credit arrangements into prepayment arrangements. It's got people who are struggling with the equivalent of that, particularly in off-gas areas where they're having to pre-purchase for the winter amounts of oil or LPG or solid fuels or biomass. You know, there are lots of contextual issues that suggest that we have to do much more, because we're not at a place where people are able to, if that's even the right phrase, enjoy the levels of warmth and comfort in their homes that they experienced pre-pandemic. We're not there. We have much higher levels of fuel poverty. So we have to do much more and do much more with what we do have. And whilst this is maybe not an issue for this particular committee, clearly one of the key aspects of that is to reduce those levels of consumption in a safe way by improving the efficiency of their homes. And if we did so, the call on some of the benefits that are being provided could be reduced, simply because people have less of a need to have something that is called a winter heating payment if their resilience in their home is such that they perhaps did not need it for that purpose. They may have other income issues and other things that they are struggling to receive. But for me, this benefit is called winter heating payment. People's expectation is that it will provide that. What we can see immediately is that the level that it's set at will provide very little. As welcome as it is for those that receive it, it will still afford them very little.
Sorry, Fraser, can I just stop you there? Because we've got something going on in the background and I don't want us to not be able to hear your answer. I think we're okay now. Sorry to interrupt you. I just, as I say, wanted to be able to hear you. So if you could carry on now, that'd be great.
Thank you, convener. I thought that was the hook coming from a pantomime, saying, like, time you're off. It's that kind of time of year, isn't it? But my key thing is, you know, the expectations for people who receive this is that this is about heat. And it was obviously a key aspect as to why it was renamed from low-income winter heating assistance to a winter heating payment, that it affords people heat and warmth and provides a comfort that it's going to be there. So the fact that it is indeed predicated around providing for heat, then that for me, we have to look at the value of this. And, you know, as I say, the £50 is not sufficient and hasn't kept pace with the changing cost of energy. And therefore, the amount of heat that it provides is considerably less. And I guess I would always ask, the purpose of the payment, is it just simply financial or is it indeed about heat? Because if it is about equity for that heat, then it would have to be significantly higher than it is.
Thank you for that, Fraser. I'm sorry for that feedback. I think we picked up everything you said, and specifically, I think, around maybe a call for more also around insulation programmes, I think is what you were pointing towards. Finally, I wanted to ask a question with regards to extending eligibility and what the panel's view was with regards to winter heating payments being extended to support terminally ill people as well, and if you've done any work on that specifically. I bring you back in, Fraser.
Okay, I mean, I think it's been quite clear that in all the one-off support that's been provided over the last 12 months by governments, that there has been insufficient targeting for people, particularly people with life-impacting, life-changing, life-limiting conditions. There's been very little that's been done that recognises that those households have significantly different needs to live in warmer homes for longer periods of time, and there simply has not been sufficient protections put in place, indeed, for many of those households, whether that's with the regulator Ofgem, and therefore for leading through into our energy networks and our energy suppliers. But equally, we've called many times for there to be specific financial supports provided for people whose circumstances could be classed as life-limiting, life-impacting, life-changing, people who've got active cancer diagnosis, a DS1500. None of that has been provided, or people who've got dialysis equipment, oxygen equipment that needs to be running potentially 24/7. Nothing has been provided that differentiated for those households. And I think that that's something that we should be looking at, whether this is right for this benefit or not. I think the key thing there is a call to provide that support.
Thank you. And Mark, did you want to come back in?
Sure. I think I would probably agree with the gentleman in Fraser's closing comment there that that it's not necessary, winter heating payments not necessarily the right vehicle for that kind of support. I think if you're, you know, if you're on a terminal, if you have a terminal illness, then you know, as disability assistance rolls out, then you're very likely to be receiving the disability benefit. So if there's also qualifying low income benefit coming into the household, then you will benefit from that. I think I mentioned in response to Jeremy's question earlier that for households including a disabled person who are not on a low income benefit, who are higher earners, that it's a separate conversation, and it's about responding to the extra cost of disability rather than responding to low income. So I think there's a case for looking at it, but separately to this.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Miles. I will now move to questions from Deputy Convener Emma Roddick to finish us off.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to pick up, Fraser, on a few things you've said, because you've mentioned the fabric of houses a few times now at this point. And there are obviously a lot of factors contributing to fuel poverty. But I wondered, you know, in an ideal world, if we could tackle it from every angle, how big a role should social security ideally play compared to, you know, regulating energy companies, the fabric of buildings, and the overall design of energy policy? So there's really no getting away from the fact that energy is expensive right now, whether it's individuals or the government that's paying for it.
Scottish Government's fuel poverty strategy recognises those drivers, and I think it's important that we continually recognise those drivers, that it's not a single approach that will make the difference for households. In Scotland, half of our homes are essentially deemed as inefficient homes. They're below a line. And let's not say whether that line is the correct place or not, but nonetheless, half of them are inefficient, and they're not evenly distributed either. You know, there are different, that varies across our local authorities and in our island communities. So it is a case of the quality of our homes needs to be improved, and improved at a rate of knots, for us to be more resilient in what appears to be a changing, fluctuating energy market, where at this point in time, we have little control over those prices. The affordability of energy, as one of the other drivers of fuel poverty, it is important that that is addressed. The system is not fair. It does not have people at the heart of it. It has the profits of companies overriding those very important human aspects. We absolutely believe there should be a right to have affordable energy, ideally a right to have affordable and low-carbon green energy, absolutely, but we should have a right to have that, and we should have a right to live in a home that is of a good standard, which we don't have. And beyond that, in terms of social security and income, which is for me where the other driver is, when people's incomes are too low, even if energy was cheaper, but people still lived in inefficient homes, they would struggle to heat those homes, and that would be detrimental to their health and well-being. So it has an important role to play. We should have a right to have a decent level of essential or basic income. All households should have that, and that those things together would eliminate fuel poverty to a large extent.
So overall, is the lack of specific policy in other areas meaning that social security, out of necessity, is playing a larger role than it ideally would need to?
I think social security is being asked to step up because the other aspect in terms of the affordability of energy has changed so rapidly and to such an extent. I mean, even though I said that energy prices will be treble 2020 when we get to April, that's a protected amount. If it had been left to the market price, it would have been 3.5 times more. It would have been a bit more expensive. Further expense on top of that could have been 4,000 for that modelled consumption. You know, without those protections in place, people would have many, many more people would have faced unaffordable energy costs. I think Social Security has been asked to step up because of vulnerabilities and low-income households simply being faced with bills they cannot pay. And when they cannot pay those bills, health and well-being would suffer. And we would face a cliff edge for me. We would face a cliff edge if people could not afford their energy costs. They would go without, their health and well-being would decline, the National Health Service would be put under incredible pressure from people whose health and well-being had worsened significantly. And we would undoubtedly see catastrophic deaths over our winter period, with people simply dying in their homes because they're unable to heat them. But we need all of those aspects to work better together. We need to do things faster on energy efficiency. We ought to be prioritising the fabric of our buildings and finding ways to ensure that that happens quicker. But we are not there.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Emma. Oh, sorry. Thank you very much, Emma. Okay, that brings us to the end of our questions. So thank you both very much for providing evidence this morning. The committee will consider the instrument next week when the Minister for Social Security and Local Government will be attending. And your evidence this morning has been extremely helpful in advance of that meeting. So thank you again. We'll now move into private session. Can members who are joining us remotely please use the Microsoft Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting? Thank you.